The Stravinsky Three Pieces is one of my all-time favorite solo clarinet works. First off, it is a totally badass piece. Totally badass. And although I think it's very accessible for less experienced players, and you may disagree, it has a depth that continues to interest me enough to actually practice the thing, even though I've performed it dozens and dozens of times. I recently came back to it after a long hiatus, and a long hiatus away from the A clarinet. When I don't play a lot of A clarinet and then come back to it, my fingers don't want to hit the keys right away. They don't cover the holes because everything is slightly further apart than on the B flat clarinet. With the bass clarinet, that's not a problem for a couple reasons. One, it's a much larger difference with your fingers being much further apart. And two, the holes are covered by pads, not fingers. So when I came back to this piece a few weeks ago because I missed it, I was listening to myself with fresh ears and I noticed that beside the problem with my fingers not being precisely over the holes, my fingers were just not precise enough, period. The damn thing was just sloppy, which is understandable, but I got really frustrated. So I did what I usually do when I can't play a piece that I used to be able to play well. I threw the clarinet against the wall. No, I didn't. This isn't even my clarinet. It's a clarinet that I have for sale here. But anyway, I approached the piece as though I was coming to it for the first time, albeit with a lot of knowledge about its form and theory and all that stuff, because I wrote my lecture recital thesis about it for my doctorate years ago. Yes, I am a doctor of clarinet. Wait, that's my pager. There's a polka emergency. No, I don't have a pager anymore. Here is the cool thing, though. I realized that I could break old habits and create new, better ones by rethinking the emphasis I put on various phrases. And this is what this video is about. Emphasis in musical phrases. Okay, follow me here. The word phrase, okay, we use this in music, phrase is shared with spoken language. And phrases in language are often written as sentences. So let's think about phrases for a moment as musical sentences. Sentences convey thoughts, but the emphasis you place when you speak the words in these sentences help the listener understand your intent. Here, check it out. She isn't flying to Hawaii tomorrow. 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 Now, each one of these sentences is the same, but the emphasis I put on these words changes what point I am trying to make. And the same goes in music. Think of notes as syllables and words, and the emphasis you place on a note can help the listener understand what you are trying to do musically. And with the Stravinsky in particular, because it's unmetered, you have much more freedom to decide which notes to emphasize. Pro tip, it doesn't have to be how Stravinsky has beamed the rhythm either that you see in the score. Trust me, he can't come after you to complain. So here's where I made two changes as I relearned this second movement. The first is pretty radical, I think. Purists might be offended, but I challenge those purists to hear the difference. I bet a dollar that you can't hear the difference. Wait, it's a bad idea to bet the internet. Forget I said that. So you don't have to go back to listen to the run through again. Here are the first sentences of the movement once more. I'm gonna play it the old way with the old beaming, and the way I used to play it, and I'm gonna play it with the new beaming, the way I just beamed it, and I'll show you as I play it. Okay, so the first change is that I rebeamed everything so that it ends on a main beat, that G is on a main beat. And then I learned it with these groupings. And it was so much easier for me to play. The other thing it does, though, which is the real reason I did this and the second benefit of beaming it this way, is that it brings out a hidden line that I believe Stravinsky intended. And even if he didn't intend it, I intend it. The way Stravinsky beamed it, the emphasis is on the high D and C. And since they're already going to stick out because they're loud, because they're high, they're also beamed so that those notes are on the emphasized beats in each of those triplets, if you want to call them that. Instead, I want to bring out the upward motion of the clarion E, F, and G. So instead of the audience hearing, that I want them to hear, and rebeaming it this way allows me to emphasize these notes. Importantly, this doesn't change the rhythm at all, just the emphasis I intend. So once I freed myself up to regroup the rhythm for this opening section, I went ahead and did it throughout the entire opening and the closing passages of the movement. So now this brings us to the middle section. I've heard it played with some really, really boring interpretations, almost like someone was speaking a run-on sentence with a monotone voice and no emphasis. Or worse, a monotone voice with no emphasis and broken up pauses, which makes it very difficult to understand. And because this middle section can be pretty weird for the listener, how about we organize it for them, shall we? Quick historical context. This middle section is very reminiscent of two other pieces Stravinsky wrote during this time, Ragtime and L'Histoire du Soldat. Both are from 1918, and this is from 1919, these three pieces. Interesting, to me at least, is that Stravinsky overlaps both of these two pieces on top of one another in the middle section. So there are two different musical sentences going on at the same time, and the listener is just hearing fragments of each one. You might think of it as two different characters talking to each other and sort of maybe arguing or sharing their thoughts or whatever. It's two separate ideas. The bottom line is one idea and the top is another. So I want to bring them out separately and differently. The bottom line now is reminiscent of the bass part to Ragtime, and the top line is reminiscent of L'Histoire. Now, Stravinsky gives us a clue to these two lines with his use of commas, and these two commas are what separate the two lines of the middle section. However, I don't always like to pause between these sections like most performances of this movement do. I know that there are commas there, but there are many examples of Stravinsky using commas to delineate polyphony, two different parts, visually for the performer, but which are not typically performed in practice. Refer Rite of Spring. Anyway, since I hear these similarities to these two pieces, Ragtime and L'Histoire, I want to bring this to the attention of the listener. So I do this again through emphasis. Let me play just the bottom line without the interrupting top line, just the one character. And what I like here and what I'd like you to listen to is the movement from E to F as you go through it. So you have that low E, but then in the second part, so that it goes up a half step. It's an upper neighbor. This is theory. But upper neighbors and lower neighbors are all over this piece. In fact, it's in all three movements. Actually, they are what glue the first and second movement together. The end of the first movement is the upper neighbor to the first note of the second movement. If you don't understand any of this stuff, you'll understand it when you get to, I don't know, freshman theory if you take it in college. All right, let me play the bottom line. The bottom line here. And now let me play the top line. Now this is the part that reminds me of sections of L'Histoire, specifically the first movement where the soldier meets the devil and the soldier is playing his violin. There's a line in the bassoon part, and so that's the part that reminds me of the that's in L'Histoire, almost identical to this kind of meandering line. Cool part of this middle section that I want to bring out, and it's toward the end of it before it sort of modulates back into the A part, the fast-moving part. And this is where a line is repeated, except that it's modulated up a half step from A to B flat, just like the half step from E to F in the bottom line. So again, this upper neighbor I want to bring out. Whether or not anyone is going to hear it, I'm going to be happy that I did it. So this is what that sounds like. So that is it, sort of pulled out. Let me play it for you in context now. So I want to pull that part out, and so when I perform it, I actually do put a little bit of emphasis on it. I also put a little sort of shoulder into it, a little body English, a little of the dark arts of clarinet, just so that I'm trying to sort of convey that this is a thing to the audience. And this is where the two lines merge, and then the A section of the piece takes over again. It is so freaking cool. Like in the beginning, I rebeam the line so that it emphasizes what I want the listener to hear, which is that same E, F, G. So this is what that sounds like in context. And so you can hear the bom, 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 and I de-emphasize those top notes as much as I can. I mean, they're kind of shrill up there. All right, So this is my interpretation of the second movement of the Stravinsky Three Pieces, and you likely will have a different one. In fact, I hope you have a different one. But I guess what I wanted to emphasize is that you have the authority to interpret, rebeam, rebar, whatever you want in order to accomplish the ultimate goal, which is to make sure your listeners understand your intent, your musical intent, just like a sentence. Thanks for watching, and we will see you next time. Take care. Bye.